The all-new MegaPodTastic Podcast is brought to you with the help of our Patreon patrons. So a special thank you to William LaBruna, Sean Fisher, Martin Collins, Todd, Liza W. Rudolph, Jim Simon, Bill Greenan, Melissa Bartell, the Bathtub Mermaid, Joey Hockey Puck, Joey Baseball, Chris Fiore, Rick Weaver, as well as our friends at Water Tower Cinema. If you'd like to support the show, please go to patreon.com/megapodtastic. Remember, Patreon patrons get special access to all the live videos of our podcast recordings on Tuesday nights, several days before the podcast goes out to the general public. Thank you for your support.
We got something for you. We got something for you, you, you.
It's something Megapod shiny. It's wrapped in Megapod plastic. Put on your Megapod jammy.
It's time for MegaPodTastic. MegaPodTastic. MegaPodTastic.
Good morning, Megapodlings. It's Krazy Joe.
This is Jacob.
And we are hoping, amongst hopes, that this recording goes smoothly and that we don't have any of those weird fluttering sounds. We got a guest tonight. It is MetrObelisk Radio himself, Gary. Welcome to the party.
It's me.
We got a jam-packed show for you tonight because we weren't here last week, in part because, the debate was just so stimulating. How could we be expected to record a show when that fine political discourse was going on? I think we all walked away a little wiser. We all learned a little something from, I can't say that with a straight face. Okay. I was getting over being sick. And Jacob, you had something going on last week too, didn't you?
Yep. I was self-quarantining last week.
Oh.
Someone I knew, actually one of my family members had COVID, so I had to self-quarantine. So I worked from home for a week, and we're good this week. Everything's good.
Excellent. I don't know. I read a tweet, though, that says COVID's nothing to be afraid of. Let's not talk politics. We got a lot on the agenda for today. So why don't we, because we missed a week. And, everything under the sun happened. So we need to talk about it. We got a ton of predictions. We got some high fives. So let's get right to predicting. You guys ready to predict?
Yep.
Yeah.
First thing, let's start right off with Regal Cinemas is closing their doors this Thursday. This show goes out on Friday, so if you're listening to this show and you want to see a movie at a Regal, you should have gone yesterday, because today you're a day late and possibly a dollar short. They are not open due to the lack of movies, which is interesting, because I'm finding that what we have going on here is a strange catch-22. Regal Cinemas is closing their doors due to the lack of movies coming out. But a couple of the movies that are coming out may get shelved now because Regal is closing their doors. So the number two theater chain in America is not going to be open. So we might see Wonder Woman and a couple of these others get bumped now because Regal's closing their doors, and Regal's is closing their doors because they don't have enough movies to show. So it's this strange catch-22 we're in. What do you guys think of this?
I'll go first. I don't have any Regal Cinemas around me, so honestly, I don't have much of an opinion about it. I still don't have movies in Michigan at all, so it's,
that's the other thing.
Not a big change.
That's the other thing. A lot of states, like you got Michigan, LA, New York, theaters still aren't open. So I don't know. It's a pain in the ass, man. Everyone's like pointing to like Tenet and saying it underperformed. And it's like, well, did it really underperform, or did just not enough people get to see it because we have all these spots that won't open their damn theaters? I don't know. You probably would have gone out to see Tenet, wouldn't you?
Yeah, I would have had theaters been open in Michigan. Absolutely.
Yeah. So I don't know. We got to get those damn theaters open. That's what do you think, Gary?
Well, for starters, I probably wouldn't have gone to see Tenet. I'm not much of a Christopher Nolan fan. And I think it's actually smarter for Regal to close up shop now. Because didn't No Time to Die get delayed, and that was the final nail in the coffin for him?
It kind of was. I kind of feel like all the theater owners and NATO, which is the North American Theater Owners Association, I think NATO and the studios and the theaters all really should have sat down and had a plan made. I think because everyone's kind of doing their own thing, because you got Regal closing, you got AMC saying we will not close, you've got release dates changing every 5 minutes. It's like, it seems like if everybody got together and was on the same page and said, we're going to open this movie, we're not going to bump it, we're going to keep this right here, come hell or high water, and let's do that, then reassess. Like, I think everybody would be in a better place.
Oh, did you hear that now Hollywood's like petitioning Congress for a bailout for the movie theaters now because studios won't release their movies to it?
Yeah. Yeah. I hope it works. I hope they get their bailout. God knows everyone else gets a bailout. The banks get a bailout. The difference is this is a viable business that wasn't struggling until this damn. It's not like they screwed up. You know, it's not like they made bad business decisions. This was out of their hands. So I don't know. It's a tough situation.
Yeah, but definitely what are they calling? Is it Premiere Video on Demand, PVOD?
Yeah.
Yeah, that is not the future of the movie industry. And look no further than Mulan.
Yeah.
How well did that do on Disney Plus?
Terrible.
Because depending on what analyst you listen to, it either only made like 30 to 35 million, or it made as much as like 260 million. But obviously PVOD, they're going to keep those cards close to their vest.
Yeah. And also Soul, Pixar's Soul, Disney was considering putting that on the same model, the premium Disney Plus, just like Mulan. And as soon as the numbers for Mulan came in, they went and cemented the theatrical release date. So they were like, well, that didn't work. Let's get this. And I think Pixar, Soul, I think that'll do better in theaters than Tenet because it's more of a crowd pleaser kind of film. So.
Yeah, but to get back to the Regal closing, I didn't mean to cut you off. I say it's a smart move because then they can at least, you know, guarantee that their expenses are going to go down. Because I just read where, like, AMC has, like, barely any liquidity left. They've only got, like, another, you know, like, 6 months of cash on hand. And after that, what are you going to do? So, yeah, AMC's not going to close. But if they run out of money and there's no movies to show, well.
Yeah, Regal's in a different situation than AMC, though. So, I know Regal's got. But I don't think closing is necessarily a bad idea. But I think it's premature. I think it's premature. I think they got to find out if Disney's going to hold firm with Soul and with Free Guy. And if Warner Brothers is going to hold firm with Wonder Woman. As soon as one of those gets pulled, I'd say, yeah, no, all bets. And I think AMC will close too. If one of those movies gets pulled, I think AMC closes too. But
did you see Did you see on Ryan Reynolds' YouTube channel the new trailer for Free Guy that he's in now? Yeah, where it's like, wait, we got to come up with new release dates. You know, movie coming out Christmas Day, coming out New Year's Day, coming out Labor Day, coming out National Pinecone Appreciation Day. Because the theaters just keep delay. So who knows when Free Guy's even going to come out.
Yeah, it's true. So I don't know. We'll see. I think Regal's being premature. I think closing's a necessity if more movies get bumped, but I don't think they're there. I think AMC's being smart because AMC, they can still go down the same route, but they haven't committed themselves yet. So I think they've got a little more wiggle room right now than Regal's given themselves. So but we'll see. The other thing that I forgot about that you guys reminded me, it seems like a lifetime ago, we just found out that Jamie Foxx is coming back for Spider-Man 3. Electro, Spider-Man, Amazing Spider-Man 2's Electro is coming back for Spider-Man 3. I can honestly say I didn't see that one coming. I don't know that anyone saw that one coming. No, Jacob, what are your thoughts there?
Yeah, it seems like it seems like one of those dreams where you wake up and you're like, man, was that a real idea? And then you look at your text message from Joe and you're like, no, that wasn't a really bad dream. That's legit. Jamie Foxx is going to be in the third Spider-Man movie with Tom Holland. So very weird. I think I sent it to you, didn't I?
And yeah.
I think we both fact checked it because it didn't seem real. It seemed like, oh, man, what's that news site you always trash?
We got this covered. Yeah.
It seemed like it would have generated for something like that, like crazy off the wall, never going to happen. Nope, this is happening. That's insane.
Well, the fact that the Hollywood Reporter was the first one to break it, I think that legitimized it a lot more.
Yeah. Yeah, and Jamie Foxx has already come out and talked about it. So it's there's no two ways about it. It's happening. It's a strange thing because I hated The Amazing Spider-Man 2. I do think Amazing Spider-Man 2 was the worst Spider-Man movie ever made. But I'll say this. I don't think Jamie Foxx was a bad Electro. I think Electro's true identity, Max Dillon, before he has the accident that turns him into Electro, I thought that was awful. That reminded me of Jim Carrey's Edward Nygma from Batman Forever. I did not like that. But once the transformation was made to Electro, I thought he was fine. It wasn't like a performance issue. Like, I mean, he gave a fine performance as the character. It just is a crappy script. So I don't really have a problem with him getting a second shot at it. But it raises questions. It raises questions like, is he playing the same Electro? Is this a multiverse thing where the Electro he played before is coming in contact with Tom Holland's Spider-Man? Or is this a case of the same actor playing the same part, but in a different universe? Like this, he's playing Electro again, but it's not the same Electro. It's the Electro of, I don't know, Earth 2, or, you know what I mean? So.
Right.
Which way you think now,
has that happened before where an actor has played the exact same role, but it's not in canon, whatever you want to call it?
J.K. Simmons. Spider-Man Far From Home.
Yeah. J.K. Simmons played two different versions of, what's his name? J. Jonah Jameson. And we had Paul Rubens played the role of the Penguin's father in both Batman Returns and Gotham. So it's two different continuities.
Interesting.
So, yeah, I don't know. We've seen stuff like that before.
Well, I guess Michael Keaton now, right? You could count that one.
But Michael Keaton's playing the same one. Michael Keaton's playing the Batman from the 89 film. So I don't know. I don't know.
Speaking of Amazing Spider-Man 2, with how terrible that was, does everybody forget that they tried to set up their own Spider-Verse back in the day? Because they were totally building up to the Sinister Six, Six at the very end. Try saying that five times fast. Because you saw the Vulture's wings, Doc Ock's arms.
I'm still disappointed that didn't happen, too. Because the Sinister Six movie was going to be written and directed by Drew Goddard, who gave us, Cabin in the Woods. So I was really excited for the Sinister Six movie because I, as much as I hated Amazing Spider-Man 2, I always say different filmmakers you know, different writers, different filmmakers, you're going to get a different result. So the fact that Spider-Man 2 was garbage really didn't dampen my enthusiasm for what Drew Goddard was going to do with it. So I still to this day, if we ever do get a Sinister Six movie, I hope they bring Drew Goddard back and let him do what he was going to do, because he's one of those guys in Hollywood who's just, he's so good and he doesn't get the attention he deserves. So we'll see.
Yeah, that. I just looked up because I forgot he had written The Martian as well. That Goddard guy.
Yeah.
Drew Goddard.
He was a writer for Angel as well. Wrote some really good episodes of Angel. Well, speaking of the MCU, last time we did a show, Jacob and I, we discussed the casting of She-Hulk. Well, we have another bit of casting. Gary, you wanted to talk about this one.
Yes, so, I did. The Ms. Marvel Disney Plus series has been cast, and I would like to take this time to stroke my ego a bit, because I'm going to say this. I called this one right after, Joe, you and I did our MCU ranking back in April.
Uh-huh.
A week later, I did a MCU Infinity Saga retrospective, if you will, predicting Phase 4, and the one thing I predicted was Ms. Marvel was going to, they were going to pull out, they couldn't do Carol Danvers for obvious reasons, because she's already been Captain Marvel in the MCU, and there's only been four Ms. Marvels total, and only two of them are known, so the only other one that they could use was Kamala Khan. Moving on over. Rocking on over. Now, if I had to put money down on which Ms. Marvel that Marvel Studios would use, it's going to be Kamala Khan's Ms. Marvel, just based on the fact that she is the most recent. Also, Kamala Khan was used as Ms. Marvel in the video game Lego Marvel Super Heroes 2. Because you can't use Carol Danvers, because Carol Danvers in the MCU is Captain Marvel.
And now, back to authors!
Well, the Disney Plus series is going to center around Kamala Khan. That's Iman Vellani.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with this actress at all. I've never seen her before.
I looked at her IMDb page just prior. This is her only acting credit.
Okay. So we'll see. I mean, Kevin Feige has proven time and again that he's good at casting. So, or whoever does the casting for the MCU movies. I don't think anything's been poorly casted yet. So I've never heard of her, but I'm sure she'll do fine.
Are either of you familiar with Kamala Khan's Ms. Marvel from Jacob? The comics?
Jacob, are you familiar with her?
I'm not very familiar.
Okay, because her Ms. Marvel is pretty weird. Because she has, like, this power where she can, like, shift her body mass around. So she can make her arms really skinny and her hands really big. So in live action, I think that's just going to look really, really weird.
Yeah, every time I see a picture of Ms. Marvel, she has huge hands.
Yeah, that's Kamala Khan's Ms. Marvel. Mm-hmm. The one that has, like, the Lone Ranger face mask.
Well, there you go. I'm going to be watching. I'll watch whatever they put out, so I will definitely check it out.
And I would just like to make a mention. I love the fact that one of my predictions actually came true. That is saying a lot more than some other people, but at least I have this to add to my cred, so stroking the ego a bit. And now I'm overstroking the ego.
Well, Jacob, you wanted to talk about a couple things. Why don't you tell us what you got for predictions?
Sure. Well, we're on the Marvel train, if you will. We'll talk about another I'm not familiar with at all, but a Hulu debuting their latest Marvel show. Is it Hellstrom? Hope I'm saying that correctly. Actually, October 16th, so a week to the day this podcast airs, it's going to air on. And they've dropped the trailer. Basically, I'm going to watch everything they put out, but it looks interesting. I'm going to check out the first episode in a week.
All right. I'm wondering if we're having a connection issue. You're coming through a little rough today, Jacob. Are you there?
Did you get any of that then? You want me to
repeat? Oh, you know, I yep. got it. It was a little crackly, but we did get it.
Okay. So. Yeah. I'm just I'm not familiar with this at all. I believe it's I think it's somehow intertwined with Doctor Strange, but I could be way off base.
And it's going to be on Hulu.
What wouldn't surprise yeah. me is if they pulled another Netflix with Hulu. You know how like Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Luke Cage was all separate from the MCU and that all built up to the Defenders? Because this is going to be a horror series, so it's probably going to be more for adults than anything.
Hmm. I'm not familiar with this one at all. I'm going to have to look up this trailer when we're done. And yeah, tells a standalone story within the MCU. Well, Wikipedia is saying it is part of the MCU.
Yes, I'm reading CBR.com, and they are saying it's going to be TVMA.
Wait. Executive producer Jeff Loeb, ABC Signature Studios. That means that they're going to say it's in the MCU, and Kevin Feige will never, ever, ever acknowledge it.
Jeff Loeb, was he the same guy behind Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Daredevil.
Agent Carter.
Every one of those shows. Jessica Jones. Basically, Jeff Loeb and the Marvel TV people were reporting to Ike Perlmutter, the head of Marvel. And Kevin Feige hates Ike Perlmutter. So there has been a pissing contest going on where Kevin Feige refuses to acknowledge anything that happens on those TV shows, to the point where we're hearing rumors that Daredevil's going to get recast when he shows up in the movies because Feige doesn't want to acknowledge the TV show. I think it's petty. I think the fans lose out. I think it's I don't like it. So I keep hoping that Kevin Feige kind of comes to his senses and gets over it and acknowledges the work those guys did, because the fans were told when Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. premiered and everything, we were told it's all connected. In fact, that was the hashtag it's all connected. And Feige has worked overtime to make sure it's connected as little as possible.
I thought they connected it with Age of Ultron in the very beginning. Because wasn't there like a 3 or 4 episode run of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. where it was like about finding Hydra and that snowy tundra, and it concluded with the very opening of Age of Ultron?
Yeah, that's pretty much the last time it was connected. As soon as Feige got autonomy and was able to report to Alan Horn instead of Ike Perlmutter, all connections basically stopped. To the point that Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. took place during Infinity War, and the snap wasn't even mentioned. It's like, that's a pretty big thing. How are you not going to mention that? For five years, half the population was gone, and you just ignored it. So
I actually thought that was for the better of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. giving it a new life. Now I don't have to watch 23 movies to watch these, 22 episode seasons.
Yeah, but it's sloppy storytelling though. This thing's supposed to be happening on the backdrop of this other thing, but I don't know. It reminds me of when Voyager went back to 1996 and we all knew the eugenics wars and Khan was supposed to be going on then, but they kind of swept it under the rug like, oh, that was happening somewhere else. That was happening, but not in L.A. Well, there we go. Hellstrom. Jacob, you were telling us about The Boys. Spinoff of The Boys.
They are doing they just greenlit, so this one's been, I think, 2 or 3 weeks ago now. They greenlit Boys spinoff. I believe it's set to feature the 7 Young Avengers style, so before the events of the TV show. It's pretty exciting. I actually don't know if this one is based in the show is based on is primarily linear, like it doesn't go backward. But that's just my knowledge of it. I could be off base here, but it's very interesting because we're getting more from this universe, and I love The Boys. It's a shame that this Friday is the end of season two already.
I still haven't even started watching season two. I'm still on, I got two episodes of season one left. I might be starting season one over again. I might be starting it from the taking it from the top, because now Christine wants to watch it. So,
yeah, that's been my experience. The first season I watched with the wife because she was kind of, but the second season, it's now a show where when one of us leaves the room, we pause it. Like then we're watching it together. It's pretty good. I recommend it to most people who ask, you know, what should I watch?
You know, Jacob, we're getting a really bad connection with you tonight. You're breaking up quite a bit.
Everything appears fine. Do you want to try the call again or?
Yeah. Let's hang up and try it one more time. Maybe we'll get an improvement. All right, and that's a good place to break. So we're gonna end this call. Try the call fresh, and we will be back with the damage report.
He can compile C with his bare hands. He speaks the binary language of moisture evaporators in three dialects. He invented binary. He is the most interesting geek in the world.
I don't always listen to podcasts, but when I do, I listen to Technorama. Stay geeky, my friend.
Hey everybody, this is Zachary Levi, and you're listening to MegaPodTastic.
Ready? 1, 2. Mediocre minute. Meh. Mediocre minute. How was that?
We are back with the Mediocre Minute, and Gary, you had something for us on Mediocre Minute, didn't you?
Yes, I did. It's a Disney Plus movie, and it's Phineas and Ferb, Candace Against the Universe. And Jacob, you're around my age, right? You're about 24,
25? 26, so close.
Okay, well, whatever. We're only a couple years apart.
Sure.
So, did you ever watch Phineas and Ferb on the Disney Channel back in the day?
No, not personally. I think my younger siblings did. I know my so I'm aware of the show, but I never watched it.
Okay, and Joe, I assume that Phineas and Ferb's a little after your time, because it premiered in the summer of 2007.
Yes, I've seen it. I really like it. I've seen several episodes. I think it's a very funny show. So I definitely enjoy Phineas and Ferb. But I first experienced it. An ex-girlfriend of mine, her daughters were really into it. So that's where I first saw it. And now I'll watch it every now and then with my daughters. And yeah, I dig it though.
Yeah, the show is definitely better than the movie. You know, the movie's not terrible, but do you ever watch a movie and you feel like it's just way too fast-paced for its own good?
Yeah, I've seen movies like that before.
That's this movie in a nutshell. And keep in mind, this isn't like a made-for-TV movie like that first movie was. That was Across the Second Dimension, where they had to fit everything within like under an hour and 20 minutes. I think this movie's about 10 minutes longer, and each of the songs in the movie don't go any longer than 2.5 minutes.
It sounds like the writers are used to a formula, and they're sticking to it even though they don't have to.
Well, what I'm reading on is that the actual, like, you know, with the animation, they do all the voiceover work first, then the animation second, right?
Yeah.
So this was being recorded as early as 2018. So my thinking was that this movie was originally going to be on the Disney Channel, but then when Disney Plus launched, Disney retroactively ordered that this movie go directly to Disney Plus instead because it's Phineas and Ferb.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense, especially with the timeline. And what you're saying, I haven't seen the movie, but what you're saying, that sounds, it sounds like it was a made for TV movie that they just decided to move.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Also, I think, like, remember the character of Candace, a very one dimensional character. The only, what's the word I'm looking for? The only purpose that she serves in the show is just to bust her brothers. Well, the entire movie revolves around her and her alone. So how do you revolve an entire movie around, you know, just a one-dimensional character and shove these three-dimensional characters basically to the background?
Well, that does give you opportunities, though. Because when a character is very ill-defined, that you have the chance to flesh them out then and make them more than that. Doesn't sound like they did that, but it's something that can be done. But I remember years ago there was a push to get a Captain Sulu show for UPN. People were petitioning UPN, create a Captain Sulu show. And I heard a lot of people say, well, Sulu's not that interesting. Sulu's very, very one-dimensional. And I always made the argument, yeah, but if he was the lead of a show, he couldn't be that way. They would have to flesh out his character. They would have to give him more backstory and more, like, I don't think he would have been the same. I think after you saw the final result, you wouldn't have said he was two dimensional anymore. But mm-hmm. But then again, it's all in the writing. As any, you know, these things are all in the writing. So
Is it funny that immediately when you said Captain Sulu, I automatically thought of what the Green Hornet was called in Asia, which was the Kato show?
From what I understand, Sulu's name in Japan on Star Trek was dubbed as Kato.
That I did not know.
Yeah, well, because Sulu isn't a Japanese name. Sulu was actually came from the Sea of Sulu. It was supposed to be Pan-Asian. So you didn't really know what Sulu's origin was. You know, he was, you know, a vague Asian origin without giving him a specific nationality. But when the show aired in Japan, they wanted him to be Japanese. So they dubbed his name in as Mr. Kato, because that is like such a common Japanese name. It's like Smith over there. So in Japan, he was Mr. Kato. But anyway, we are tangenting, as we often do. So Phineas and Ferb, the movie, is mediocre, is what we're hearing. I haven't seen it. Jacob hasn't seen it, but I'll have to check it out. And I'm sorry to hear it wasn't a little better.
It's not terrible, but it's not great either. It's mediocre. It's the very definition of it.
Well, there you go. All right,
but
well,
just wait till you get to the adulting song. That song is an earworm.
Well, from mediocre to damage, let's get into the damage report here. First thing I'm putting on the damage report is Netflix. Netflix is going on the damage report because they have canceled Glow. I believe they were on our last damage report because they canceled Dark Crystal: Age of Resistance. Yep. That one hurt me to the core, but it's a little more understandable because the show was an expensive show and it wasn't really doing so well for them. But Glow is a hit. Has quite a following. It won Emmy Awards, and it was renewed for season 4. Season 3 ended on a cliffhanger. They renewed it. They said it'll be back for a fourth and final season, and now due to COVID and the inability to get the show filming, they've reversed course and said, nope, now thanks to COVID, we have to cancel the show. I'm putting Netflix on the damage report because I think this is a really horrible thing to do. Show ended on a cliffhanger. The fans were looking for resolution. And this is not an unsuccessful show. We get it. We get it. You can't shoot now. You're not going to make whatever your targeted release date was. You don't know when this show will be able to go back before cameras. We get it. But we can wait. Rather, we got that final season, wrap up the storylines. I'd rather get it late than not get it at all. And frankly, I think Netflix is going to have to go back and rethink this decision, because if you look at Twitter, people are pissed. This show has a loyal fan base, and they are not happy that this show was suddenly unceremoniously yanked. So I guess my question for you guys is, were you fans of Glow, and how do you feel about this? Jacob, you were a fan, right?
Yeah. I've actually only ever watched the first season, although it's always on my watch list, especially because it's on Netflix, so it's easy to binge. But it's a double-edged sword for me, because I'm a fan of the show and I'm also a wrestling fan. So I had the actors, like, I have them on social medias and Twitter, and there were people who were, that was like their first acting gig, and they were genuinely sad. And it was like borderline heartbreaking, if not heartbreaking. It sucks, to be blunt. I think it's a shitty move on Netflix part. You know, it's not like we needed season 4 in 2021 or even 2022. Just, you know, eventually when you can.
And that's why I'm saying I think Netflix is going to have to revisit this decision, because they're getting a lot of flack for this one. I mean, they've been canceling stuff left and right lately because of COVID. We got Dark Crystal. We had I'm Not Okay With This. We had a couple others. But this one, man, this was a hit show for them. This is like, I don't know. It's like CBS saying, oh, we're going to cancel The Big Bang Theory because of COVID. It's like, well, that's one of your big hit shows. By the way, I hate that show. But that's beside the point. It's still a hit. Like, you don't. I don't know. The show deserves more respect. Let them finish their storylines. Even if they came out and said, we'll do a movie. We'll do like one more feature length, like episode, you know, a movie to wrap up plot lines. I'd be satisfied with that, but you can't just end it the way that it ended, because it didn't end. It ended with a tease for next year of, oh, well, here's where this story is going. And I don't know. Gary, were you a fan of Glow?
I've heard of I've never seen the show, but I'm familiar with the actual league itself, the Gorgeous Ladies of Wrestling.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, from what I'm hearing, I think they canceled it simply due to contractual reasons. Think about, what if the actors get other work during this time? And it's like, well, you know, okay, let's call up Netflix. Hey, are you going to need, oh, we don't know when production's going to resume. All of a sudden, that's going to turn into such a quagmire for them to try to get everybody back when they need to, because in those contracts, you know, they can't hold them to one job indefinitely.
That's true, but there's ways around it. There's definitely wiggle room. I think this is temporary. I think, like, when the haze of COVID is past, they can actually sit down and start figuring out the logistics, and they might have to bring them back to the table. I don't know, it's just my guess, but I can't see this one sticking.
And apparently they already completed filming on one episode before they were forced to shut down.
Yeah. And what happens to that one episode? Do we at least get to see that? They shot it. I mean, it's not like they're going to leave us with any less resolution than they already did.
Joe, I'll bring up a perfect example for you. And I know you're a fan of this show. Remember Farscape?
Yeah.
Remember how it ended? It ended on a cliffhanger. But then Sci-Fi canceled the series. There was a huge fan outcry. And so was it Hallmark Channel or a Sci-Fi Network greenlit Peacekeeper Wars?
I believe it was Hallmark. I think it was on the Hallmark Channel.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, it was like a 3-episode miniseries that was going to wrap up, you know, the cliffhanger ending of season 4.
Right.
And wrap up the series in general. I'm thinking if there's enough fan outcry, we're going to see a very similar thing with Glow. Maybe not a 2-hour movie, because I don't know the storyline at all. I haven't seen 1 second of the show, but, you know, do like a, you know, 3 or 4 episode miniseries and just wrap everything up.
Yeah, I think that's what's going to happen. I can't imagine it won't. But for now, I think fans of the show have been kind of screwed on this one, because I'm of the opinion now that no show at all should ever end their season on a cliffhanger unless there's a guarantee of another season. Because how many times have we seen this? That, you know, you're watching a show, you like it, and then it just stops. You don't get any resolution. One show I remember that I really liked that did this was Reaper. It was a show, Reaper, on CW. They ended season two with a cliffhanger. There was no season three. So, no, this just seems to be standard procedure now. End your show on a cliffhanger and then try to negotiate it. But this one, they were even told you had a fourth season. They had it.
Right.
Got taken from them. So, I don't know.
Yeah, and before we move on, I don't know if you guys are wanting to move on after this, but what I was going to bring up is this is, you know, the what am I thinking of? The failure of streaming, of just releasing every single episode all at once, because didn't that happen with The Dark Crystal recently?
Yeah, well, that's every Netflix show. Netflix drops all episodes at once. Jacob and I have talked about this.
That was a bad idea.
I think it's a terrible decision dropping all episodes at once. I think you need to do a weekly schedule, because
look at the success of The Mandalorian, and that released only once a week.
But you know, I'll tell you, I'm concerned that Disney is going to an all episodes at once format. Which I think
they're doing that with 616, that documentary series on Marvel and their creators.
They're doing it with 616, and they just did it with Earth to Ned, the Henson series about the alien with the talk show. They dropped all episodes at once. So I don't know. Disney's flirting with it. I don't know if they've made a full commitment, but they're flirting to the all episodes at once model. And I don't know. I just think it's such a bad decision.
Well,
for a couple of reasons. Number one is it kills the buzz. It kills the buzz. Like, when you go week by week, you have people talking about your show for like 10, 13 weeks. When you do all episodes at once, people talk about it for maybe a week and then they're over it.
Mm-hmm. I was going to bring that up where shows take time to build their audiences. Now, some can knock it out of the park, like, you know, like Glow did. I think Daredevil hit it out of the park the first time. But let's also keep in mind, they're the exceptions, not the rule here.
Right. Stranger Things is another one.
Yeah. Forgot about that one. Handmaid's Tale apparently got big on Hulu. But how many Hulu shows have gotten canceled just after one season?
Yeah, Hulu has not had the success that Netflix has had when it comes to TV shows. Like, I mean, Handmaid's Tale. I think Handmaid's Tale is probably the only show on Hulu I can name. Oh, you know what? No, there was another one that's pretty good. Future Man. Future Man on Hulu had some buzz about it. But anyway, but before we move on from Netflix, you had, Gary, something else for the Damage Report, and it's also Netflix related.
Yes, it is Netflix related. Enola Holmes dropped on the 23rd of September. Now, have you guys heard of this movie?
I've seen it.
Okay. Yep. How about you, Jacob?
I've heard of it. I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because it was originally supposed to get theatrically released, but obviously with COVID, Warner just decided to sell off the distribution rights to Netflix and just get their money back, obviously.
Yeah. So you were not a fan of the film?
No, not at all.
Okay. I have some things to say about it too, but I'm gonna hold on to them for now. Why don't you tell us a little bit of your criticisms?
Well, one of my bigger criticisms is all the fourth wall breaking that they do. Yeah, I get it that they did it in Deadpool, but to me it becomes too cliche and too cringy, where it's like, oh, we got to stop what we're doing and, you know, wink at the audience or start talking to them. It's like, I know what's going on. I don't need you to iterate it for me again and again.
Okay.
And also, I'm watching this movie, and I'm thinking the entire time, why couldn't we get Sherlock Holmes 3 with Robert Downey Jr. and Jude Law?
Well, we are getting something
I actually wanted was that movie.
Well, we are getting that. That's getting ready to start shooting pretty soon.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, in fact, it just was in the news today that Robert Downey Jr. is trying to create a quote unquote mystery verse at Warner Brothers. He wants to, after Sherlock Holmes 3, create some Sherlock Holmes spinoff movies so that they have like an interconnected mystery universe. I don't know how I feel about that. I want to see Sherlock Holmes 3, but that seems to be taking things, maybe a step too far.
Well, then Enola Holmes is immediately out of that running because Sherlock wasn't played by Robert Downey Jr. He was played by Henry Cavill in this one.
That's yet another superhero Holmes. We got Iron Man Holmes, Superman Holmes, and Doctor Strange Holmes. So they're the superhero. So, In fact, I saw a meme that had the three of them on it. It said, you either die a hero or live long enough to see yourself become Sherlock Holmes. So well, let's take a quick break and come back with high fives, okay?
Hey, all you fans of hard rock and heavy metal, come visit Mordo's Metal Museum and enjoy some obscurities from my personal music collection that I've amassed for over 40 years that you will never hear on the radio. Bootlegs, bonus tracks, FM radio concerts, and more. Mordo's Metal Museum is available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Facebook, and the Mordo's Metal Museum website. So come have a shot of Jägermeister with me as I dust off some nuggets from my archives. The show is curated, hosted, and produced by me, Eric Mortensen, the Metal CPA from the San Francisco Bay Area.
Hey, metalheads, this is Gary Holt from Exodus and Slayer, and you are listening to Eric, the Metal CPA on Mordo's Metal Museum, the podcast. Crank it up!
Hey, this is Neil Grayston, and you're listening to MegaPodTastic.
Code 5, repeat, code 5.
1.
2.
3.
4.
5.
All right. It's high five time. And I got to say, I was going to give a high five to Enola Holmes. I really enjoyed it. I especially enjoyed Millie Bobby Brown. I thought she was really good in the part. I thought she was actually downright delightful in the role. And this is the only thing well, that's not true. I've seen her in Stranger Things, obviously. But the only other thing other than Stranger Things I've ever seen her in was Godzilla. And that Godzilla movie was not great. this is really the only thing I've really, really seen her have a lead role in other than Stranger Things. And I thought she was really good. And I liked Henry Cavill, too, as Sherlock Holmes.
See, I wish that they showed more of Henry Cavill as Sherlock Holmes. That way they can at least kind of get away from the Robert Downey Jr. and Jude Law movies, because let's be honest, Robert Downey Jr. is getting up there in age now, because isn't he in his late 40s, early 50s at this point?
Oh, yeah, he's definitely in his 50s.
Yeah, so do you think he's going to be wanting to play Sherlock Holmes for the next 10, 15 years?
I don't know.
Here's Henry Cavill, who's only in his mid-30s.
I don't know. I mean, time will tell. So, Jacob, you had a high five for us too, right?
Yes, sir. I am giving a high five to the recently released on physical media movie called The Silencing.
Okay.
The movie was released on September 29th by Lionsgate. It stars, I butcher his name every time, Jamie Lannister. I don't know how to pronounce his real name. It's like Nikolai.
That's his name now. We just call him Jamie Lannister.
Jamie Lannister. but it's not really a horror. It's like a crime thriller with a mystery. Look like a classic B movie, you know, one discernible star, not much, you know, going forward. I didn't hear anything about it besides the press release from Lionsgate when they sent it to me. But it was pretty entertaining. I was genuinely surprised by it, and I really enjoyed watching it. I think I gave it like a 3.5 out of 5, which, I mean, I really enjoyed the film. I actually recommended it to a couple of people because it was good.
All right, I'll have to check that one out. I have not, I haven't heard of that one until you mentioned it.
Yeah, so. It's a, I believe it was, and I couldn't tell you if it was ever supposed to be released in theaters. I just know it came to physical media on September 29th.
Okay. Physical media only. Interesting. It's an interesting choice that they didn't go to a streaming service with it. That's kind of breaking with the times.
Well, it's along the lines of a lot of Lionsgate puts out. I know they put out like Retribution with Orlando Bloom, and I Am Vengeance Retaliation with Vinnie Jones and Stu Bennett. So it's along those lines, but of all of those movies, it was good. It was good enough they could have released it in theaters, and I would have watched it.
Okay. And Gary, you had another, you had a high five for us, right?
Yes, Amazon Prime's revival of a Eco Challenge, also known as World's Toughest Race. And okay. are either you fans or Survivor?
I am.
Jacob, are you a fan of Survivor?
Nope.
Oh, that sucks.
Not that I'm not a fan. It's not no hate on the show. I don't know if I've ever watched an episode. Just indifferent.
Okay. Well, what I was going to say is Eco Challenge is the predecessor to Survivor. That's what Mark Burnett was doing back in the mid-90s. I think it originally was on the USA Network. And the last season aired in the early 2000s. And it was as a result of Survivor's success why the show ultimately got canceled. But yeah, they brought it back with Bear Grylls hosting.
Okay, I'm not familiar with the show. I'll have to check it out. I hadn't heard of it.
It's a lot different than what you think. It's not like an Amazing Race type of show. Basically, it's 65 or 66 teams are running a course that's like almost like 1,000 miles long across the island of Fiji. And there's only 3 ways to get eliminated. You either don't make the cutoff time, you have to be rescued for whatever reason, or you quit voluntarily.
Okay. All right. That sounds interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking up Eco Challenge now because I'm not familiar with it at all.
Oh, yeah. In the final season, the final season, I think, aired on Discovery. There were quite a few Survivor contestants were competed in that one.
Huh.
Yeah, Ethan, winner of Survivor Africa.
Well, that's interesting. Okay.
Yeah, my only criticism for Amazon is that they aren't showing those older seasons of Eco Challenge, and since they want to bring back this revival, show those older seasons for, you know, people like myself or Jacob, where Eco Challenge was just a little before their time, so that we can watch it. Because, you know, I felt watching this, you know, with like, because you'll come across a guy like Mark Macy, apparently had done every season since the first one. I had no idea who he was. I didn't know about his development at all. And they were constantly bringing up that final season that aired in like 2002. And I'm just like, okay, I'm just going to have to take your word for it at this point.
Huh. Well, that's interesting.
So you're saying they just they don't have them up there? They just don't have the streaming rights?
I don't know if they don't have the streaming rights, but I know that Burnett owns his own production company. So if Burnett is the one that greenlit the revival, why not try, even if you don't have the rights to the original Eco Challenge, to bring them back? Because Amazon's got, you know, a word I can't say on this podcast because this is family friendly, but they've got a crap ton of money. You know, they can shell it out to get the streaming rights because, well, money talks. And like I said, if you're trying to revive an old property, you know, from like 15, 20 years ago, it might be better to advertise, you know, hey, watch these older seasons first up and, you know, and then we'll premiere this, you know, revival series and we'll go on from there.
Yeah. And you don't have to list it as season X, you know, you don't have to start with the sequential order. You can say it's a reboot, but you could also have them available, you know, the top suggestion. Hey, you like the new Eco Challenge? Check out the old ones. It reminds me somewhat of when they debuted Fuller House. When they debuted Fuller House, Full House was not on Netflix. And it's with these streaming services, I just think a scenario like that is just ridiculous.
Wasn't it on Hulu at the time?
Hulu got the rights to all the TGIF shows, like every ABC TGIF show from the 90s. They wanted to like recreate the TGIF, so they were like, we got Family Matters, Full House, Perfect Strangers, like every one of them, Step by Step.
Yeah, so it seems like a huge misstep. You know, you could have had, and again, Fuller House is not completely separate, but it's a separate show, so it doesn't have to be Full House season 10. But in the same thing, if you had both on there, I just think it, you know, people could, who aren't aware of what Fuller House is, they could stream Full House, and then the top suggestion would be Fuller House, and they're automatically going to watch it. Same with the Eco Challenge. It just seems like they have to have the companion series. You almost have to.
I mean, yeah, because, you know, Eco Challenge isn't like a Hollywood Squares type show. Where do either of you even remember that series?
Oh yeah.
It started in the 70s. Then Whoopi Goldberg revived it in the 90s. And didn't they try another revival just recently, like within the last 10, 15 years?
That I don't remember, but I did watch the original with my dad back in the day in the late 70s, early 80s. And then I remember the late 80s, it came back with Joan Rivers. Joan Rivers was Center Square. And then in the 90s, they brought it back with Whoopi Goldberg as Center Square. And that one is memorable because Gilbert Gottfried was on it.
You fool!
Yeah.
So you gotta look that up on YouTube. It's really, really funny.
Yeah, the You Fool episode is legendary.
And it wasn't Gilbert Gottfried that actually started that too. It was Penn and Teller.
Penn and Teller, yeah. Yeah, if you've never seen that, Jacob, do you know the premise of Hollywood Squares?
Yeah, yeah. I've seen it parodied on enough things.
Yeah.
And I've seen it I've seen the show, like screenshots of the show, but to say I've sat down and watched an episode would be a lie. I've never even seen it airing on in syndication or anything. So I'm just aware of it.
It's tic-tac-toe rules, and they needed
right.
Both sides needed the square Gilbert Gottfried was in to win. Nobody could win if they didn't get Gilbert Gottfried's square. So they had to keep choosing Gilbert Gottfried, and every time that, you know, the premise is the host asks the celebrity a question and the celebrity answers and you have to say if you agree or disagree with their answer. And whatever Gilbert Gottfried said, the one side would, you know, agree or disagree, they'd be wrong. And Gilbert would go, "You fool!" And then they'd go to the other one and they'd go to him and it became this big thing where they just couldn't get away from Gilbert Gottfried, and he just kept screaming, "You fool!" like over and over. It's legendary. It's on Netflix. It's on YouTube.
You would think that eventually they would just go with the other option, because remember on Hollywood Squares, the celebrity didn't have to get a single question right. They could totally mess with you if they wanted to intentionally. Right. As long as they say the answer with a straight face, what does smog mean? And I could sit there, look you dead in the eye and go, "Smelly fog." And I could trick the person into agreeing, even though you and I both know that's not what smog means, but it didn't matter.
Right.
No, when I think of Hollywood Squares, remember the episode of The Simpsons where Homer bowled the perfect game?
Yeah.
And they get him to be a center square. So do I read from the sheet that says jokes or answers? Ah, crap, that's it. Stop the filming.
What's really fun about Hollywood Squares is they would shoot a whole week's worth of episodes in a single day. And Thursday and Friday were the best days to watch Hollywood Squares. Thursday and Friday, the best days, because they would shoot the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday episodes in the morning. Then they would break for lunch and they would drink. So by the time they came back to shoot Thursday, Friday shows, the celebrities were drunk. Anyway, we are tangenting about Hollywood Squares here. So World's Toughest Race, okay, it's on Amazon Prime. We'll check that one out. And I got two more things for the high fives. Number one, a movie Jacob and I have talked about quite a bit, Unhinged. Unhinged took great pride in being the first movie to open with theaters. They wanted to be the first movie out of the gate so badly. Now, I saw the trailer. It looked fine. It didn't look like anything I needed to see. So it's been out a couple months, and I hadn't seen it yet. So I mean, that tells you how anxious I was. Thing opened in like August, and here we are in October. I hadn't seen it yet. But there's not a lot out right now. And I want to support my local movie theater, Water Tower Cinema. I like going out and showing them some support. And you don't have much to choose from. And also, I kind of wanted to just support Unhinged for the sheer tenacity of saying we want to be the first ones out the gate. So I went and saw this movie. Holy God, it's one of the year's best films. I love this movie. Now, granted, when I say year's best films in 2020, that's a low bar because very few movies have come out this year. But this movie is so entertaining. It is, it's intense. There's an intensity to this movie. It's got a little bit of Falling Down with Michael Douglas, but Russell Crowe's character is so much more deranged than the Michael Douglas character ever was. Wow. Enjoyed the crap out of Unhinged. Big high five. Highly recommended. So that's my the biggest high five I have to give goes to Unhinged. This is a movie that I hope people find this thing one way or another, whether it's going out to their local theaters, if that's an option, or checking it out when it comes on video or streaming. I mean, this is one people should see.
Yeah, you won't have to wait that long. I've actually already gotten the press release for Unhinged, November 17th. And per your recommendation, I think when you texted us and said that Unhinged was awesome, I have already requested it. I'm very excited to watch it because apparently in Michigan, the fucking movie theaters are never going to open. So I might as well watch it on physical media and support it. So yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I mean, you heavily praising a movie that you and I had talked about it, but it was more along the lines of, hey, this is the first movie to come to theaters, not, hey, this looks good, you know?
Yeah. Actually, we should talk after the show. I'll ask you that question after the show. I got a question about the press release, but That could wait. That doesn't need to. I really liked this. I guess officially the movie's a thriller. Sure. But I would actually say it actually starts to border on horror. It kind of walks that line between horror and thriller, and I have one criticism, and it's about the end of the movie, so I'm not going to say what it is because I don't want to tell anyone how this movie ends. But once you've seen it, once it hits physical media, I think you and I should revisit this because I want to have the spoiler discussion at that time.
That sounds great. I am totally up for that. I would have loved to see it in theaters and talked about it now, but again, the cards were dealt.
Yeah, you got to, you know, you got to pick up and move to Pennsylvania. That's what you got to do.
That yeah, I'll get right on that. Let me text my wife. But our governor is actually supposed to have a press release literally the 8th, with a Thursday before this drop. So who knows? Movie theaters might be open just in time for there to be no movies to watch.
Or maybe her press release is just to say that Unhinged is going to be available on physical media November 17th.
Yeah.
Jacob,
hey, look at this press release I got, everybody.
Didn't your governor just get sued?
Yep. That's mine.
And the courts didn't go in her favor.
Correct. They thought she was overstepping her bounds, essentially.
You know something? That same thing happened in Pennsylvania. Governor Wolf got sued. And he lost, and they said that his emergency measures were unconstitutional. And it pisses me off, because Governor Wolf did a great job. He did a great job. Like, I mean, if you look at the number of COVID cases, Pennsylvania, we started off as one of the worst. He really got it under control. So it's like, what he did worked. And I'm like, oh, yeah, and we're going to sue him now. That's great. And I don't, and he didn't go as far as, like, your governor, like, you know, the movie theaters were allowed to open in July and everything. But I don't know. I feel like our governor got a raw deal. Like, he really turned things around in Pennsylvania and then got punished for it with a lawsuit.
Yeah, it's not usually something I comment about because I'm not a political beast or being, but I just think it's wild that we still don't have. I think the only two things that aren't open are literally bowling alleys and movie theaters. Like, I think over a month ago she opened gyms, you know, like Planet Fitness and stuff like that, and you know, football games, so you can, you know, be within 5 inches from each other and touch each other. That's fine, but you can't go to the goddamn movie theater, you know. So it's frustrating, and I've talked about it a lot on the podcast, but there's nothing I can do about it, so I don't even worry about it.
You know, I don't know if you, I talked about this on my live stream tonight. I know you probably didn't catch the live stream tonight, Jacob, but they did research, because, you know, they're tracking the COVID. When people have new cases of COVID, they ask where they've been, and they kind of track places where they might have caught it. Do you know how many new cases of COVID have been tracked to movie theaters?
I'd say like 0.5%.
Zero. Not a single one. They've been tracked to bowling alleys. They've been tracked to restaurants. They've been tracked to bars. They've been tracked to, like, all these places that are open. And yet we keep reading articles in the media about how the movies are so unsafe. This is the most unsafe place you could be. I can't tell you how many articles I've read about that. And not a single case has been tracked back to a movie theater yet. So it's one of these things where it's like, what is going on? Like, Andrew Cuomo in New York won't open the theaters. He opened the bowling alleys. He opened the restaurants. What's going on here?
It's a very weird scenario. Now, again, there's probably a fraction of the movie theaters open.
Yeah, that's true.
So I'm sure the statistic would be higher. Obviously, anything is higher than a zero, but it's not going to go from a zero to 100. You know, I'm sure it would go up into the maybe high teens if they were to open every single movie theater. But to just across the line say everything except movie theaters can be open, it's just asinine, and it seems like a very weird decision. We can have bowling alleys and bars, but
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you. But people keep saying to me how dangerous the movie theaters are. And I swear, I go to a movie theater and I sit alone. There's nobody near me. There's nobody behind me. There's no one in front of me. I have so much space in these movie theaters because of the limited seating capacity. There's nobody anywhere near me. Then I go to the supermarket, and there's always somebody who's wearing their mask, like not wearing it at all, or they have it pulled down, so they're wearing it like on their chin, but their whole mouth and nose is exposed. And that guy's in the same aisle as you, trying to reach for the same grocery you are. So it's like, I don't feel safe in the supermarket. I got people like literally up my ass in the supermarket. Half the time they're not wearing masks. Then I go to the movie theater and I'm sitting completely alone. And then I read an article telling me that's more dangerous. I'm like, what world are you living in? this is the safest place other than my own home. This has got to be the second safest place there is.
Yeah, and it's
that's from experience. I'm saying that.
Yeah, it's a very strange decision in an environment where we can have schools. Now, if movie theater seatings are comparable to anything, it would be like a school environment. Now, obviously, they can't always social distance in schools because of limited seating and limited classrooms. But school opens, then you're going to mandate schools be open, but movie theaters can't be open. And I've got an example just like you with the supermarket. I recently, again, being quarantined, so potentially being contagious, I ordered a sub from a Jimmy John's, and I told the person contact-free delivery or contactless, whatever, meaning they would drop the thing off at the door and they would drive away. It's pretty simple. Now, mind you, the guy knocked and would not leave the sub at the door, so I had to come out, again, during a quarantine, potentially contagious, sign the guy, use his pen, you know, he handed me the drink and, you know, brushed my hands, and there's way more dangerous things than sitting in a chair 5 feet from somebody else.
Yeah.
There is absolutely no way to just, even on a quarantine, I still had interactions with some guy who then went back to his work, who then had 80 other deliveries that day. There's way more dangerous stuff than sitting in a room that you're supposed to be there. You want to be there. It's not like the supermarket where you don't want to go to the supermarket, but you have to. You don't have to go to the movies. Joe Schmo Dickhead, who's afraid of giving COVID, doesn't have to go. And Joe Schmo Dickhead, who has COVID but needs groceries, doesn't have to go to the movie theaters.
Right.
You know, you're scared to go into the movie theater. That's obnoxious. What are you going to think? Someone's going to lay their head in your popcorn? No, you're still socially distanced. And just don't interact with people. But let us have our goddamn movies.
Yeah, if you don't want to go, don't go.
Right.
No one's forcing you to go. If you don't feel safe, don't go. But there's no reason other people should be kept from it, especially when we see just how safe it is. But there's not a single case being tracked back to movie theaters. But hey, we're tangenting again. And I got one final high five for the night. This one is a 2018 film, so I'm coming to you late with this one. But the other night, it was a nice night. It was Friday night, I think. It was a nice night, and I decided to go take the movie screen. We have a screen. Take it out in the backyard. Get a lawn chair and my projector. And I watched a movie in the backyard that I'd never seen before. It's been in my digital voodoo collection for quite some time. I think I picked it up for like dirt cheap a couple years ago and just never got around to watching it. It's called You Might Be the Killer, and it stars Allison Hannigan from Buffy the Vampire Slayer and a bunch of other people I've never heard of before. And the premise is just, it's just such a fun movie. It is so much fun. I really loved this movie. But the premise is Allison Hannigan's working in a comic book store, and she gets a call from her friend, Sam. He's a counselor at a camp, and he calls to tell her that there is a serial killer at the camp, and almost all the other counselors are dead, and he's hiding. And as she starts asking him questions like, oh, my God, well, where are you? But as she's asking questions, he doesn't have a lot of details about the killer. And she starts piecing things together and says, you know, I think you might be the killer. And it turns out Sam is the killer, and he has no memory of doing it. He doesn't know what possessed him to start killing the other counselors, and he has no memory of doing it. And it is really, it's a horror film, it's a comedy film, it's both in one, and it is a blast. It is just so entertaining to watch. This guy who is unaware, he's blissfully unaware that he is the killer stalking the other counselors. And once the realization hits him, oh crap, I'm the killer. By now his other camp counselors are coming after him because, he killed most of them. And it's just a blast, man. I can't say enough good things about this. One thing I will say is a title that's been popping up at Dollar Trees lately that I really like is a movie called Final Girls. Final Girls. I think you watched Final Girls, Jacob, if I'm not mistaken. I really liked Final Girls. And this movie is the perfect pair for Final Girls. You could watch Final Girls and You Might Be the Killer back to back. You got a perfect double feature right there.
With regard
It's a.
No, I was going to say with regard to You Might Be the Killer, maybe Sam's son drowned in the lake when he was just 9 years old. Everything you described like screamed Friday the 13th.
Oh, it's very Friday the 13th, but it's satirical. It's like it's all the cliches. It's basically all the cliches of everything you think you know. But the gag is it's Jason. If Jason thought he was one of the counselors and didn't realize he was the guy killing them.
And it's if Jason didn't cut the phone lines.
Yeah.
Which probably should have been the first thing that Sam did, but whatever. I get it. It's a comedy.
And it's just really, really fun because the whole movie, we got Allison Hannigan on the cell phone kind of advising him. And as she's asking him questions and finding out what's going on, he's telling her. And her customers in the comic book store are overhearing the conversation. And they're hearing her say things on the phone to her friend like, "So you decapitated him?" And then they're all looking like, "What?" I'm telling you, this movie is just if you find this movie, if you come across this movie, I say this is a big pick it up.
That's awesome. It's a couple things. I wanted to point out that I love that to you when you think Allison Hannigan, you think, "Oh, she's from Buffy." Whereas personally, when I think Allison Hannigan, I think of How I Met Your Mother immediately.
Ah.
Oh, I'm surprised neither of you went with American Pie.
I'd like be this disappointed
one time at band camp.
Gary, I was going to be disappointed if you didn't say American Pie because we had to get all corners of the Hannigan career here.
Because I was originally going to say How I Met Your Mother, but again, she's probably more famous for it's like this one time at band camp.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard the song Allison Hannigan by the German punk band Wax On, Wax Off?
Allison, no Allison, why don't you join my band? So you could play the flute like this one time at band camp.
No.
Is it like the Uma Thurman song that Fall Out Boy did like a few years ago?
I don't know that song.
That's
Wax On, Wax Off.
I'm sure you've heard it, Joe.
They did a song called Allison Hannigan, and there's a line in the song where they sing, "Allison, no Allison, why don't you join my band? And you could play the flute like that one time at band camp."
Except that would suck. No, knowing where the flute got caught, I'm not going to say it here because I'm going to keep it PG-13. But it's a place that you really – that for boys, you don't want to get hit in.
Yeah, it is. Going back to the movie, it is available on Hulu, Joe. I know you and I talked about that. I've actually added it to my Hulu watch list.
Okay, here's the question, though, Jacob.
I will watch it very shortly based on your high recommendation.
Well, here's the question, though, Jacob. Do you have Hulu? What's it called? Hulu Live?
Yes.
Okay. Because I don't. I have regular standard Hulu. I own the movie on Vudu. It's not an issue for me. I own the movie. But I did see that You Might Be the Killer is only available on Hulu Live. So if you have regular standard Hulu, you won't be able to watch it. But if you have the Hulu with live TV, you can watch it on Hulu.
Yeah, it's in I think it aired on Sci-Fi, which is why I get it, because I have Hulu with live TV. So basically, it's just like I recorded it. But yeah, it's on Hulu Live if you have live TV, and if not, it's actually not available to purchase anymore on Vudu, Joe, which is surprising.
Oh, that's disappointing. I wonder what's going on with that movie. I'm recommending a movie.
I'm sure you can get it elsewhere.
Yeah, I'm recommending a movie. It would suck if I'm telling people you got to see this movie and nobody can get it. I wonder if it's on
it's not available on Prime. I lied.
wonder if it's on Amazon Prime or iTunes or any of the other places people get movies.
Right now, not available on Prime, which means it's more than likely not available on movies anywhere. Watch it be on like Tubi.
Yeah. Oh, if it's on Tubi. Oh, you know, funny story. And this is a total tangent. But I found out, like, I was watching a YouTube video the other day, and I found out that there was like a documentary about the life of John Ritter called John Ritter Behind Closed Doors. And I saw this on YouTube, a clip of it. And I said, oh, I wonder how I could watch that whole movie. And I said to myself, I bet this is on Tubi. And I went and, yeah, it was on Tubi. It just happened to be on Tubi. So that, you know what? It looks like You Might Be the Killer is not on iTunes. Oh, man, that sucks. This movie that is great. You can get the original soundtrack. You can get the soundtrack on iTunes, but not the movie.
And, of course, it's always available on physical media. Always. So you don't have to stream it.
Yeah, from what I think I checked that, though, and it looks like it's it's on DVD for $17, but the Blu-ray, if you want it on Blu-ray, it's $40 and out of stock, yeah, so you can't get it either.
Yeah, I was about to say, I ain't paying $40 for a Blu-ray. That's ridiculous.
Yeah, it's there's one copy on eBay for $25. But it looks to be out of print, which has been a big budget.
That's weird, too, because the movie's only 2 years old. This is a 2-year-old movie. It's already out of print.
Was it an independent movie?
Yeah. Yeah. Here's something funny. The last go around at Dollar Tree, the last time movies hit Dollar Tree, there was a movie that I know a bunch of us picked up called Trailer Park Shark.
No.
Did you didn't pick that one up, Jacob? I know Joe Martinez got it.
Who would buy? Only you and other Joe would buy that movie.
Joe Martinez picked it up.
Us bought Trailer Park Shark.
I picked up Trailer Park Shark. Joe Martinez picked it up. I know Movie John over at the Movie John channel, he picked it up too. But the funny thing is, I just picked this up like last week at Dollar Tree, Trailer Park Shark. Then I watched this movie from 2018, You Might Be the Killer, and Allison Hannigan's character, in the store she worked in, there was a poster for Trailer Park Shark behind her hanging on the wall. And I'm like, ah, I just bought that movie.
That's funny.
So that's all I got for tonight. If you can find You Might Be the Killer, by God, you're in for a treat.
Sounds fun. I'm excited to check it out on Hulu. I really am.
Yeah, you better check it out quick, though, because with it being out of print everywhere, I'm afraid Hulu's going to yank it soon.
for some reason. That's a good point. I wouldn't be able to watch it without buying it, and I'm not – yeah, it's a good point.
It's a conspiracy to keep people from watching this movie. I don't know what's going on. All right, guys, that is it for this week. I'd like to remind everyone, if you sign up for our Patreon for just $1 a month, you will get to access these podcasts before I go to bed on Tuesday, whereas everyone else has to wait till Friday. So, but the live video feed or filming or recording or whatever will go up on the Tuesday before I go to bed, maybe Wednesday morning. I don't know. And you can find us, of course, at megapodtastic.com. If you want to say something, get on our voicemail line. You can call us at 610-624-1985. Again, that's 610-624-1985. And it just occurred to me, I forgot to check and see if we got any new reviews on Apple Podcasts. So let me take a look real quick and see what we got, see if there's any new reviews showing on Apple Podcasts. And oh, by the way, the last review, we didn't know who it was. It was Gary!
Yeah!
It was Gary. Awesome. He's 465, right? Yeah. So that was Gary. And no, Gary, you are still the last one to review the podcast. So.
Woohoo! And I've got a bone to pick with you, Joe, because you didn't know how to pronounce Ori.
Yeah, that's because it's from SG-1. I wasn't a fan of SG-1.
Did you get very far into it?
Off and on for all 10 years, I kept trying, and I never could. Sure. I liked Atlantis.
Atlantis was good.
I liked Stargate Universe too, but SG-1, I always had trouble getting. I didn't like the movie either. I actually don't like the movie with Russell either. So
yeah, because what I was about to say, the Gwal-Old was the main villain for like the first 7 seasons. Then it went to Anubis. And then when Ben Browder came into the show, because obviously Farscape got canceled, both him and what's her name? Who played Aaron's son?
Claudia Black.
Thank you. Yeah, when they came in, that's when the Ori came in. That was the last couple seasons.
Well, but that's it. And now, Gary, why don't you tell our listeners where they can find you?
Okay. Well, you can find me over on YouTube at the MetrObelisk Radio YouTube channel. And I assume that you want me to spell it out, Joe.
I'll put a link down below. So,
well, I was going to
spell it out. You can spell it out.
I was going to spell it out anyway. It's spelled, with a capital M as in MetrObelisk Radio, E as in it's MetrObelisk Radio, T as in Tim, look over there, it's MetrObelisk Radio. Please tell me you get what I'm referencing.
No.
Family Guy with Robert Loggia.
May I have your name, please?
Robert Loggia.
Can you spell that for me?
Certainly. That's Robert Loggia. R as in Robert Loggia. O as in, oh my God, it's Robert Loggia. B as in, by God, that's Robert Loggia.
As in Robert Loggia.
I love Robert Loggia, but I don't think I've seen that Family Guy.
Okay. Well, I'll spell it out normally. Capital M, lowercase E-T-R, capital O, lowercase B-E-L-I-S-K, space, radio. I assume everyone knows how to spell radio. You can also find me over on Twitter at MetrObelisk, spelled the same way as in the YouTube page. And if you want to follow me on the Blogspot. I treat that more like social media than anything. That is metrobeliskradio.blogspot.com.
What if they want to follow you on the street?
Well, then I'm going to probably run for the hills. And in my state, it is stand your ground. So all I'm going to say is you better be careful. If you are watching the video feed, tomorrow is the start of my horrorthon on the YouTube channel. So stay tuned for that.
Did you say the horror-thon?
Horror-thon. Entire month of October, we are looking at all horror movies, and we are starting off with the critically acclaimed series Sharknado.
All right, and Jacob?
You can find me at youtube.com/J2H, J-T-W-O-H, Instagram and Twitter, underscore J2H, J-T-W-O-H. New videos Tuesdays and Fridays, so check them out.
All right, and I have decided that I am going to start ending my videos and things with the sarcastic Vulcan salute. So I say to everybody, keep wearing those pajamas.
Keep wearing those pajamas
with the plastic feet.
Keep wearing those pajamas.
Tell everyone to me.
Keep wearing those pajamas.
With the back door flap.
Keep wearing those pajamas.
Don't open it, it's a trap.
Oh, oh,
it's a trap. Some people call them
peaches.
Some people call them
jammies.
They can come embroidered with big money and no whammies. They can have 100 tiny commander adamas. But no matter how they look, just keep on wearing those pajamas.
Keep on wearing those pajamas. Keep wearing those pajamas.
I know we're having fun.
Keep wearing those pajamas.
And now the song is done.